Hi everyone, my name's Declan McGlynn and today we are joined by one of House Music's biggest producers. He had a UK number one with his remix of Storm Queen and continues to play the biggest clubs and festivals all over the world. We're going to talk a little bit about his career, his approach to music making and DJing and all that kind of stuff. So please, welcome MK.
How you doing, man?
How you doing?
Good.
Welcome to Point Blank.
Thanks.
So we were literally just talking about the infamous Jamie Jones Snapchat.
Yeah.
So that was in Ireland, you were saying?
Yeah.
God, the Irish.
Yeah, it was funny because it was the weekend I played a festival called We Are Festival in England, and there's a festival called Life Festival just outside of Dublin. So I was playing on a Saturday in We Are Festival. Jamie Jones was playing on a Saturday in Dublin. So after Saturday night or Sunday morning, I flew to Dublin. Jamie was flying to England to play We Are Festival. So we literally saw each other in the airport, high five, Snapchat. He goes and plays VR Festival. I go to Life Festival. And so I get to the festival, and usually what my manager and I do, we walk in the crowd just to get a vibe. Yeah. And I was walking around, and I heard this girl say, "Oh my God, there's Jamie Jones."
So you knew already?
Yeah. And I kind of laughed. I'm like, oh, that's funny. Every once in a while, that does happen.
Oh, he's a handsome guy.
Yeah. So they run over and they're like, "Can we have a picture?" So by the time they came over, they got to me, they figured out I was MK. So, you know, we take a picture. And after the show, I fly back to California. So it's like a 10-hour flight. So as soon as I land, my phone is like blowing up. Like every DJ that I know sent me the picture. Like, "Oh my God, have you seen this?" And it just went viral overnight. And I talked to Jamie about it and he was cracking up. He said, "Mate, it's the first time I went viral." So it's been funny.
Yeah, it's funny because he actually took you out of semi-retirement, is that right?
Yeah. Well, it wasn't so much retirement. Yeah. I wasn't making house music anymore.
Right.
I was producing pop music. Mm-hmm. I think at that time I was probably working with Ariana Grande.
Right.
And so he reached out and asked about me playing one of their hot creation parties. And I'd always wanted to get back into house music for a couple years prior. And I thought that was like the perfect time to jump back into it.
Mm-hmm. You know, why was that?
I didn't really know so much about Jamie Jones and Lee Foss and Hot Creation and even house music, but I just started digging into it. And they reminded me of myself in the 90s when I was doing house music. Mm-hmm. And they were doing the kind of music that I liked. It wasn't too EDM-ish. It wasn't too progressive. It was like cool house music. And I thought that's a good point to jump back in it point.
What was that process like?
It was hard. I thought it would be easy, but it took a while because I wasn't used to house music at that time. I was used to 90s house and what I did in the 90s, but there was a whole 10 years of house music that I've missed. So I kind of had to go back and do homework and make new music and figure out what works and what doesn't work. So that took a minute.
Yeah. You know, and was there a key bit of kit or production technique that brought you back in?
I kind of continued where I left off, and where I left off was mostly analog equipment. And at this time, I remember I didn't have a sampler. Right. So I'm like, well, how do I do dubs? Because before I was using Akai S1100, you know, in 1994. And now it's, you know, 2010, and I don't have that anymore. And I remember I bought a machine that I was using for my pop productions, but it was still confusing for me at first, the machine was, so I wasn't using it too much. And then I thought, like, I know I can chop vocals on this thing. I just got to figure out how to use it.
Yeah.
And so I just stayed with it and just kind of kept using it and using it. And then I kind of figured out the best way to use it for myself, for what I'm doing dubs and chopping vocals. And it kind of started with that. And once I got to doing house production and chopping the vocals, everything else kind of came naturally with the rest of the music. And I would still always stick with, like, 909 kits, even still today.
Yeah.
I stick with 909 drums. So, and it was just drums, a dub part of the vocals, and a bass line mostly. And I started adding chords to it later on, a couple years later.
So was the old Akai stuff originally? Is that how you made it, just in the same process as machine? I mean, what's that process look like when you're chopping up a vocal?
Well, in the Akai S1100, back then, what I would have to do is take the vocals, usually from a DAT, and record it live into the sampler. So if I recorded I would just basically record all the vocals, if I remember right, all the vocals. and because I had a maxed out 1100, so yeah. I had a lot of memory so I can fit all the vocals. And I would just scroll through it and find chop points that I like. There's some samplers now that have auto chop, yeah. where it chops it at the peak points, yeah. but I don't necessarily like those because it's chop where I don't chop at peak points. I go through like sonically and find something that sounds cool. So, you know, I have to manually do it. And I pretty much do the same thing in machine. I just import all the vocals and literally scroll through a start point as the track is playing though, to find something that sounds cool. And then just go from there and find one sample, then another one, till I have a whole pad.
Yeah, the whole bank. 16, yeah.
Sometimes I don't need 16, but usually 8 will do it. And I just kind of in real time just play the track and just kind of mess around until I get something I like.
Yeah, and when you get the stems in for remix, I mean, what makes you accept it? What makes you go, I can do something with this?
I listen to the vocals first.
Right.
I actually hardly ever listen to the music.
Really? Is that intentional?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But now, if I have the option, I'll say send the stems. Usually my management will listen to the song and say, you know, it's a good song, you should probably do it. I'll give it a quick listen, but won't pay too much attention to it, just enough to where I know if I want to do it. And then if I say yes, once I get the stems, I usually just erase all the music and just start with a vocal.
Yeah.
It just makes it for, I just don't want to be doing a mix based on what the original was.
Yeah.
Because the whole purpose of a remix that I always thought was something different.
Of course.
Than the original.
Yeah. And remix culture's kind of taken on its own world now.
Yeah.
Before it was in the past. People make careers off the back of remix. I mean, you included.
Yeah.
I mean, what do you would you prefer remix things that aren't based on club stuff that are coming in from a different genre or something?
I like the different genre. It makes for a more interesting mix. Like, for example, My Head is a Jungle, a song that I did a couple years ago. The original is a folk song. And so I went, once I accepted that mix, Wankelmut, but I remixed Wankelmut's version. But when I went back and heard Emma Louise's version, it was just her playing guitar singing. So I more worked from that than Wankelmut's version, mm-hmm. and kind of just restructured it all.
And are you musically trained in that way, or you just use your ear?
No, I taught myself theory.
Right.
Because I was doing house music first in the early 90s, and once I started moving to production and producing for other artists, I realized that I didn't know enough musically to start producing pop music, so I taught myself theory, right. and just kind of chords, where to go and where not to go.
Do you think that's important for electronic music producers?
No, it's only important, it's... I hate to try to tell people how they should produce. You know, some kids don't know how to play at all and they're really good at producing, and that's fine. You know, for me it works that I know what I'm doing a little bit. Mm. That's all.
Yeah. And when you have a remix, I mean, how do you get over a creative block when there's a deadline? No more beers.
Sometimes you just have to just go through it, because I've had many remixes where I had an hour to finish it and that was it. There was no, it's either like call my manager and say, never mind, I'm not gonna do it, which I've never done.
Yeah.
Or you just kind of just finish it and you just say it's done.
Yeah.
9 times out of 10, those mixes have turned out okay.
Yeah.
And Nightcrawler's Push the Feeling On was one of those mixes where I knew I didn't have any more time to do it. So I was just like, all right, it's done. Place to learn, and light, it's up to you. Place to learn, and light, it's up to you. Place to learn, and light, it's up to you. Place to learn, and light, it's up to you.
I guess there's something liberating there, because you always have like a get-out clause in your mind of, well, you know, I didn't have
it is a get-out clause, so, but it's not, because I know they would give me hell if I said, call the label back and tell them never mind, when they've been waiting three weeks for a mix.
So. Yeah. I mean, we're always touring as well. I mean, does that affect your creativity?
Of course it does, yeah.
So when you get back in the studio...
That's my big issue right now, is being creative and touring. Most of the past 2 years, it's been, I go home, I'm home from maybe 3 days, you know, hang out with the family, and I have literally 12 hours to finish a mix when I haven't started yet. And it's that part where you're like, you have a flight in 13 hours. You have to finish it. And so there's that. And it's really hard because with me, I'm gear crazy. I'm always buying gear. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I get home, I'm opening up new boxes of synths, just cool equipment, where I'm like, I don't know how to use this yet. You know, I have so many synths at home. And the last mix I did it like all in the box. And I'm like, I need to use that so bad, but I don't have time to use it. So yeah, it gets frustrating.
So do you have any go-to techniques when you do get stuck and you're like, the deadline is looming?
Usually what happens is I start with the vocals and I try to find a chord progression that I like. Usually if I have the chord progression I like that goes with the vocals, everything else kind of comes naturally. Right. So if it's taken me longer to do a bass line, it's kind of because I have that luxury to spend a little more time on the bass line. But once I have the chord pattern and progressions I want to use, everything else kind of flows.
Yeah. And one of the key things about your tracks is that they're quite minimal in terms of there's not that many tracks.
Yeah.
But they all sound quite big individually.
Yeah.
Is that something you try and achieve?
Yeah, I learned that at an early age of producing. I used to work with Kevin Saunderson, and there was a guy that worked there named Shay Damier. He's a producer also. Yeah. And he was Kevin's A&R at the time. And Shay was the one who kind of, he would always lecture me. Like he was like my big brother. Like, MK, you don't need to put all that stuff in the track. And so I would just try to do not too much in a track. So at an early age, I learned that. And I just kind of stuck with it. Mm-hmm. And even just being a listener and a consumer, listening to pop music and the certain pop music that I liked. And whether it's Timbaland was, one of my favorite producers at the time. And his stuff was really, he didn't have that much going on. It would just be a couple of things that really catch your ear, and I always try to stick with that. Yeah. And I just try not to overproduce, because sometimes, obviously I hang around a lot of producers, and I have hung around a lot of producers. And I've seen producers just have 40 tracks of just stuff, when it's not needed. I mean, the perfect example is, I'm just using my own song, but Storm Queen, Look Right Through, that mix went number one. And it's really just that vocal sound that's talk to me, a kick, a clap, and a bass line. That's really what makes the track, And everything else just kind of adds color, but you don't really need that much.
Yeah, you can understand why people do that. I mean, it takes a lot of confidence to strip it back and just say, this is the track.
Yeah. And also, a lot of that is not having time to finish it. Because there has been tracks I'm like, this needs more in it, but I don't have time to do it.
Yeah.
But then after a couple of months it's been out, I'm like, sounds good like that.
Yeah. So I guess that's the classic thing, isn't it? Finishing. Such a classic problem with producers. It's like, when is the track finished?
Yeah.
Or getting stuck in a loop,
not
knowing how to go with it.
Yeah.
Is giving yourself a self-imposed deadline maybe a good way?
Yeah, it's the same with vocalists, too, because I work with a lot of vocalists. But I'm used to it now, so I'm used to hearing a vocalist like, I need to do that verse again. It's like, no, you don't. Sounds good.
Right.
Trust
Let's
me.
Move on.
It's good, yeah.
Just, I guess when you work alone, you don't have that person saying, it's fine, keep going,
right.
And you end up tweaking, and then sometimes you end up ruining the original idea that was there, that sparked the whole track in the first place.
There's a remix I did for Aurora called I Went Too Far, and it started out as a production for my album, and it was exactly that, because I was started with the vocals, and I found the chords I wanted to use, and I added a kick, a clap, and a bass line. And I was like, okay, I have that down. I have to go or whatever. I'll get back to it later. And when I went back to it, I was like, I don't think it needs any, much more. I added a couple more things to it, and that was it. It just kind of just felt right. Give me some love. Give me some love. Sometimes it just happens and you're like, all right, cool.
Yeah. I remember reading an interview where you said you find the mix process one of the most frustrating parts of making music. Is that still the case now?
Of what, like outboarder stuff?
Or just mixing in general?
I'm a terrible mixer. I listen to my mixes and I cringe. I'm like, oh my God.
But how do you get over those frustrations? Do you try and make it sound like a club immediately and try and get it to sound big immediately? Or are you just, in your mind?
I try to make it sound right where creatively I can still be creative.
Yeah.
And still be inspired. I try not to make it sound like a full mix when I'm doing it. But whatever I need to do to just to keep myself inspired.
Yeah.
You know, because you know, working on a song for 12 hours, you got to do something to still stay with it.
And would that be like putting a limiter on the master or something like that?
I've been doing that lately, but like one time, a couple weeks ago, I did a song and I crushed the track so much just because it sounded good at the time. But I knew like at the end of the day, I couldn't keep it on that squash. Yeah. But sometimes I do that.
Yeah. And if you want to test something out in the club, but it hasn't gone to your mix engineer to be mastered yet,
yeah.
Do you have a go-to home mastering chain?
No.
No?
No. Usually I try to do a rough mix, but I don't do too much to it because I know I always play my tracks out before anyone else hears them, before I turn them in, whether it's a remix or my own production. So I keep it kind of basic. Then I go back and see what I need to add. A few times it sounds okay, you know, where I just need to do a little bit to it. So I don't try to do a full mix down and test it. I kind of test it raw.
Yeah. And speaking of DJing, we were just talking about you're on the D2s now from Tractro.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you use four of them, even though they say don't.
Yeah.
What's that like? I mean, you're fully invested in stems now.
Yeah. Because again, I mean, Native Instruments gave me the D2s and everything when I don't even think it was out yet. So I had them in the very beginning, but I wasn't ready to make that jump yet. And plus, there wasn't that many songs out that I wanted to play with stems, and I just slowly started getting into it, and then I got, you know, more and more comfortable using them. So now I was using two D2s, and I would maybe have one stem track on deck B and just a regular track on A. Mm-hmm. And then I got really comfortable and I thought like, let me use four. And so now I moved to four. And so sometimes I haven't done this yet where I have four stem tracks playing.
Right.
I may have two stem tracks playing and two other regular tracks playing, but I haven't gone full four yet.
And is that something you've kind of always wanted throughout
yeah.
your career to be able to release stuff like that on the fly?
I mean, because I'm a better producer than I'm a DJ, I feel like. So I feel like if I can, you know, produce on stage, that would be me at my best element.
Yeah.
So using four D2s and having 16 tracks of different instruments at one time, you know, I've been doing that for 20 years. So doing it, you know, in a DJ setting is really a piece of cake.
So you just feel like you're back in the studio.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about taking stuff home or hardware live?
Eventually I am, because I'm doing my album, and I know I'm going to have to do live shows soon, so eventually, but not yet. Probably not for another year and a half at least.
That kind of line between what is DJ and live performance
is
more and more blurred. Yeah.
I mean, my idea of doing a live performance is, you know, having Logic and having certain stems set up and playing some stuff live and having different musicians play and a drummer play. So I'm not sure how I want to chain all that together yet.
Yeah. And what kind of advice would you give to some like a young producer who's in their bedroom making house music now?
Don't pay so much attention to the blogs. Because I see that a lot with the younger kids. It's like they don't know, so they're just reading what a lot of the older guys are saying. And sometimes it's not always right.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes, I mean, when I was young, I just kind of went with what I knew. I had people when I was in Detroit, when I was making a song, I had some of my older peers that were producers come in and say like, what are you doing? You know, but I'm glad I didn't listen because one of the songs I was making was burning.
Yeah.
They're like, why are you using that preset? Because it was this ugly sound and this Kurzweil rack unit, not techie sound and just a ugly sound. And they're like, why are you using that? But I'm glad I didn't listen to them.
Yeah.
You know, so my best advice is to kind of just go with what you feel like sounds good. And try not to copy people too much. I know it's hard as a producer because that's just kind of how you start out. I did the same thing, but then at some point you have to get out of it where you're trying to sound like someone else.
Yeah.
You have more success by just sounding original.
For sure.
Yeah.
All right, nice one, okay.
Thanks
for coming in.
Yeah, for sure.
Cheers.